राइट
डियर प्योर एफ बी व्यूअर्स एंड ऑल द यूरोलॉजिस्ट, गुड इवनिंग वंस अगेन. टुडे वी हैव डिस्कशन ऑन द पीसीएनएल. एज यू ऑल नो, द रिनल स्टोन इज द कॉमनेस्ट सर्जरी विच ऑल द यूरोलॉजिस्ट डू इन देयर प्रैक्टिस, वेदर इट इज प्राइवेट प्रैक्टिस और एनीवेयर. सो the most important advantage of PCNL is quickly removing large volume stones. The latest change that happened is mini perk. The change which has not happened is everybody wants to use SIAM and be safe, do 0 degree, 30 degree, above 30, 0. With that, naturally, during the puncture time, lot of SIAM exposure will be there. Second thing is, we sometimes will not be able to negotiate in difficult tracks. So today, how to overcome these small problems, because each person develops their own technique. I will introduce Harshavardhan at 5 o'clock, but I wanted to ask you, Harshavardhan,
yes, sir,
some of the things which are common to PCNL. First thing is, thank you very much for accepting the invitation. I wanted to ask you one thing. When you finished your MCH, I think in KM Bombay, Mumbai, you had good exposure to PCNL, or afterwards you learned?
So we had a very good exposure to PCNL at KM Mumbai. I almost did almost 30 to 50 PCNLs when I passed out from KM Hospital.
Who is the mentor? When, who is the mentor in KEM which helped you to learn PCNL?
Yes, sir. Dr. Mohammad Ismail sir was there. Now he is in Dhirubhai Kokilaben Ambani Hospital. And Dr. Okay. Bhushan Patil was there. So these two, they guided me through the PCNL journey, sir.
Okay. What is the technique you have learned there? Is it bullseye or triangle radiation?
No, we learned their bullseye technique. And at times, triangulation technique for some difficult punctures. Yes, sir.
Generally, when you were the place where you are, Ahmednagar, where you are practicing, after coming from the private practice, from day one, you started PCNL in your private practice without any hesitation?
It's a very good question, sir. Every urosurgeon has a fear of puncturing the kidney. Because everyone knows about the some disastrous complications, PCNL, it looks to be simple, but then when the things go bad, they really go bad. So for the first case, I still remember, and I've stored a very fond picture in my laptop, me and Dr. Yogesh, who is a very good friend of mine, and he was a senior to me. I called him from Pune just to be very careful while doing the first PCNL, and I did this on a doctor itself, and it was a stag on stone. But then that gave me a tremendous confidence to overcome all the fears, and that from that they have never looked back. I am doing good PCNL, sir.
That is what exactly I want to listen. Same thing has happened to me exactly when I started. I also kept a backup. After 2-3 cases, then that is not required. So in day to day life, do you reserve the blood for PCNL or not nowadays? Honestly. If it is a small stone, you don't reserve?
So, honestly speaking, till date, I have not reserved a single blood bag for any PCNL, sir.
Yeah, only in emergency you will get
only,
it. You have
only
the
in emergency, blood only,
available. You have the
yes,
full
yes,
blood
it's very,
facilities available.
Yes, yes, it's fully available. Only for the ectopic kidney case, which I did without doing laparoscopy, I did a complete SIAM-guided PCNL in the ectopic kidney. For that, I reserved one bag.
Yes, very good. So that you have to sometimes be careful in selected cases. You cannot go all the time. So now with this this thing, I will introduce Harshavardhan. I will share my screen. And after that, I will hand over to Dr. Harshavardhan. So As you all know that today, video-based surgical presentation is on monoplanar PCNL, how I do it, by Dr. Harshavardhan Tanwar. To be honest, the Harshavardhan is very a close friend of me, and he has a lot of interest in endourology. More than the interest, he has great attitude to learn, unlearn, and practice latest, whatever possible in endourology, that made him stood in the front line in India in management of the renal stone disease at an early part of his career. I introduce him. He is MS, MCH, urology from KEM Bombay. At the moment, he is director, Satalkar Lotus Super Speciality Hospital, Ahmednagar. Recipient of Best Resident Doctor Award, Seth GS Medical College, KEM Hospital, Mumbai. Demonstrated PCNL puncture technique as a faculty at UCCon, Kochi 2020. Participated in debate with stalwarts of Indian Urology Parkan 2020. Presented a talk on use of flexible guide system in PCNL at Advancement in Endourology Conference in 2019, AIE. Faculty and moderator for Dr. Oliver Traxer talk at RIRS versus Minipair Conference, where we have conducted in Hyderabad in 2019. That is the time itself I could realize the knowledge he has and the enthusiasm and more so the attitude. He has 25 international PubMed indexed publications. Head of PCNL Training Institute at SLS Hospital. I want to mention only one more thing I will stop sharing. Dr. Harshavardhan actually is practicing at Ahmednagar, where it is a large district in Maharashtra. A lot of constraints will be there when you practice in the early part of career in district headquarters. That's why I have purposefully given this talk to him to learn how he overcome those constraints and then developed PCNL and confidently doing daily sometimes 3 to 5 PCNLs. And then now has come to a position where he is discussing daily through the important WhatsApp group, Star Perks, where I must say some of the international faculty are also discussing. And he is able to actively maintain that WhatsApp group, which is not easy. So with this introduction, I will hand over to Dr. Harshavardhan the program. Harshavardhan, your talk on monoplanar PCNL tips and tricks, as well as the difficult tracts, how you manage in dilatation. Over to you, Harsha.
Yes. Good evening, everyone. Sir, am I audible?
A little louder, please.
Sir?
Little louder.
Sir, yeah. Am I audible, sir?
Yes, yes. A little louder you make.
Yeah. Now, am I audible, sir?
Yes, yes. Visible also, the slides.
Sir, am I audible?
Yes, yes. You are audible.
Yeah. Okay. Your slides are also good evening, visible. Everyone. Good evening, everyone. Yeah, okay, sir. So good evening, everyone. At the outset, I want to thank Dr. Chandramohan, sir, whom I personally say the superman of urology, for inviting me on his wonderful group and a great academic platform, the Pure Urology FB group, which focuses on the surgical techniques in urology. A sincere expressing gratitude from all our students and all those who learn from this group. Thank you, Chandramohan, sir, for creating such a wonderful group, sir. So, coming to the talk, PCNL is a game of judgment. You have to fit in mind all the tips and tricks, all the do's and don'ts when you are approaching a case of PCNL. Let it be a simple pelvic stone. Don't consider it as a simple one. Things can go wrong at any given point of time. The thing, the success key to the PCNL is an accurately made track and a well-maintained track. If you are not doing an accurate puncture, you are doing nothing in PCNL. Just removing a stone is not the game. How beautifully you are removing the stone is the thing which we have to do. Till date, no puncture technique is ideal in PCNL. Let it be a biplanar technique, let it be a triangulation technique. All the techniques are still in a developmental stage. No one has come up with an ideal PCNL puncture technique. It is up to you and your own modifications which make a PCNL perfect. And the aim should be safety first with zero accidents. So coming to the fluoroscopy guided percutaneous renal access, there are two types. One is supine and the other is prone. In prone, the well-established techniques are the biplanar, in which we have bullseye, triangulation and hybrid. The only untouched technique, or what we call it as the freehand technique, is the monoplanar technique. So now what is monoplanar technique? Monoplanar access technique that is different from other methods in that it uses only fluoroscopic projections maintained on a vertical plane. Here, the CM is fixed in 0 degree. The angulation of IP needle from skin surface to desired calyx is to be calculated, and the depth from the skin to desired calyx is to be perceived and is to be imagined. So the highlights of monoplanar technique are, there are two things which are very important. First is the angle orientation of the initial puncture needle, and second is the depth perception, to what depth you are going and whether you are accurately going or not. So these two are the main highlights of monoplanar technique. Coming to the literature, there is a beautiful study which was published in Journal of Endourology in September 2015, which has compared monoplanar and biplanar access techniques for percutaneous nephrolithotomy. I usually get criticized when I post a video that why don't you move your C-arms? Why don't you have seen whether you are gone to the depth, desired depth? How can you make out whether you have reached the calyx or not? Are you going too much deep? Are you remaining too much superficial? There are always criticisms which I see. But the thing I want to say here is, let it be anything. Let it be the triangulation technique. Let it be the bullseye technique. Let it be the monoplanar technique. Everybody has its own imagination about the puncture and how accurately you are going to hit the desired calyx. So when you compare the biplanar and the monoplanar group, here you can see that the drop in the hematocrit value is almost same, which is the p-value is not significant. The bleeding in monoplanar group is not much more than the biplanar group. But when you see that the fluoroscopy time, it's definitely shorter in monoplanar group, so that the CM exposure is less, the puncture time is less, the operative time is less. So in having the CM untouched or unmoved, keeping it in a vertical plane and doing the PCNL saves a lot of time and also the fluoroscopy exposure. When it comes to the complication group, even here you can see that hardly any difference is there between the blood transfusion and other major complications in both the groups. So overall, what the paper says is the best access technique for PNL has not been established yet. We do imply that trials to compare two different techniques are obviously awaited for rendering its success in PNL. So as I said, that one has to be very accurate in calculating the depth, at what depth you are going to go and at what angle we have to go. Because the CM is just showing you an image which is very different what you are going to do while doing the PCNL. So how far away is it? So the desired calyx, how far? And now in the talk, I'm going to show that how to identify the calyx, whether you are approaching towards the kidney or superficial or going deep. So in the video presentation, where I'm going to show 5 videos of some difficult cases which I have done in monoplanar technique only. So there is no ideal way to do monoplanar punctures. Perception is what matters. Every case is different. One has to orient accordingly. So this is the basic rule in PCNL. No technique can guarantee you an accurate puncture. It is always a different case and you have to orient yourself. So the first video we are coming up with is the inferior calyx puncture. So you can see this is a stone, almost a 2 centimeter stone, which is there in the inferior calyx, which is very parallel to the ureter and the PUJ. Such punctures are always difficult because you have to come very medially. Now here you can see I've calculated, I will just pause the video here. I've calculated the skin to the stone distance. I've kept my needle away in a 30 degree angle to the calyx, desired calyx that I'm going to get puncture, almost 2.5 centimeter to 2 centimeter away from the calyx. Now I will start going in. Slowly I'm moving in. See my angle. I'm directing my needle towards the calyx. Once I see that I'm hitting the parenchyma, the kidney starts buckling and there is a movement of the desired calyx also. And here I stop. So just a giveaway sensation has been felt to my hands where when I enter the desired calyx. And after that, we just remove the needle and you can see free flow of the water coming, egress of the clear fluid. Then with some maneuvering of the needle, you can easily guide your wire into the ureter. Always remember, try to put the wire in the ureter. Once this is done, your 50% job is done in a PCNL.
Harsha, I want to ask a question. Please, can you pause?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
First thing is that it appears to me that the movement of the kidney and calyx are very important in your mind. Is it correct?
Yes, sir. Number definitely,
two,
sir.
You are using which gauge needle? I want to know. You use which needle?
Sir, we use the Cook's IP needle.
Okay.
Yeah.
And what guide wire you use?
Sir, we use a Terimo guide wire 0.035.
Okay, please proceed.
Yes. Yes, sir. Here you can see that as it was a completely packed stone in the inferior calyx, it was a very minimal purchase and you have to be damn accurate when doing such cases because here the wire is slipping out of the calyx, but with some maneuverability and with some patience and you are able to then guide the wire through the infundibulum into the pelvis. The wire has walked into the ureter now. So this If this is achieved, more than 50% of job is over. And you can see here that even when I'm removing my IP needle, there is no kink in the wire. There is no kink in the wire so that it's a very straight track. It's almost 30 degree to the skin surface. And I have not moved the C-arm at all. It's all been done in a 0 degree vertical plane itself. I'm doing a single step dilatation right now. The dilator, what I'm using is the Shah's sheath I'm using. It's the Shah's dilator. Here you can see it's a very straight track which is approaching towards the stone directly. And we stop our dilatation at the tip of the calyx so that there is no mucosal injury or there is no tear in the calyx and the infundibulum.
Okay.
So I'm inserting the Shah's superpuck sheath. I'm doing a single step dilatation here. In such cases, single step is quite difficult because there is no purchase. Easily your system can come out, but there is a free flow and clear egress of the liquid coming inside from the kidney. We are flushing it from the downside, downwards from the ureter, and we are going inside. So it's a clear PCNL what we did. There was no hematuria at all. I will move on to the next video, sir. It's a middle calyx puncture, which I'm going to demonstrate. We demonstrated the inferior calyx.
Yeah.
Now in this case, it was a case of PUJ calculus with multiple secondary inferior calyceal calculi, which were radiolucent. You can see many calculi in this region. And it was quite a difficult case because you have to, this caseon was a CKD patient. You have to plan your puncture to approach the upper ureteric calculus as well as simultaneously in a single puncture, you have to approach towards the inferior calyx also. So we planned a middle calyceal puncture here. In the same way, we did the puncture again in the monoplanar technique. So we are planning a monoplanar technique. We are not moving the C-arm. The C-arm is kept fixed. You can see the C-arm is fixed in a vertical plane itself. We are going to adjust the needle angle almost 30 degree to the skin surface, which will be seen on the C-arm itself. And one should anticipate the distance from the skin to the desired calyx. That for your needle should be, and its angle should be almost to 30 degrees. So now we are starting with the puncture. The patient is in spinal anesthesia. I'm coming inside the needle. What we are doing some jerky movements so that we can feel the kidney when we are near to it. We have taken a skin puncture. Now we'll start going in with 30 degree. See, I've started moving. I'm asking the patient to hold his breath so that I can target the middle calyx. I'm at the tip of the calyx. And at the moment, again, the patient breathes. So I stop there. And when he's steady, I go inside. So we are, once the giveaway sensation is given, we'll stop there and we'll put a wire. The wire walks into the ureter straight away.
Excellent. This is an excellent puncture. Because spinal anesthesia is difficult to, both of you should be coordinated.
Yes, sir. So we do all the punctures in spinal only. I have not done a case in GA.
Oh, that is really commendable.
Yes, sir. You can see.
And the prone position also you will do under spinal?
So all prone only I do, and all are in spinal only. So now we are dilating the track. We are doing an initial dilatation is done with the screw dilator, with the tissue dilator, which is a stiff dilator. So there is no buckling of the wire on the surface of the kidney.
If it is narrow infundibulum, if you don't want to use the stiff dilator, is the alternate is there?
Yes, sir. If the infundibulum is narrow, then what I do is I do cobra catheter dilatation, sir, which is a flexible catheter which goes inside the ureter also.
If you have the video, we'll love to see that.
Yes, definitely, sir. Now I've stopped till the infundibulum. I'm not going beyond it. I've stopped here as in the calyx itself. I'm doing a dilatation with the superpuck sheath. You can see this assembly. This assembly is the superpuck sheath assembly. I go inside. You can see this stone impacted in the upper ureter. From the upper ureter, I come back and I go into the inferior calyx. So we have to plan the puncture that in a single puncture, you can remove all the stones inside the kidney. So this is the inferior calyceal stone. Sir, seen?
Yeah. Yes, exactly. Very nice.
Yes. Yes, sir. So this was the inferior calyx. This was the infundibulum.
Yeah.
I came back. Yes, sir. I came back. And so we stop here. So this case was done. Then I will like to show in the third video the superior calyx puncture technique. Now, this puncture technique, it differs from all the rest of the middle and inferior calyx because here you have to be somewhat vertically oriented to the calyx. You have to be very close to the calyx when you are coming from the skin. You have to be quite a medial because the orientation of the superior calyx is different from those of the middle and the inferior calyx. So in this video, it is shown. So this was the system, sir. I will like to pause here.
Yeah.
Here, I don't create a distance of 2.5 centimeter. In both the rest of the two videos, I showed that I was far away from on the skin surface, almost 2 centimeter away from the calyx, which I was going to target. But here you can see my needle on the skin surface is very close to the calyx. There is almost no like gap at all. Yeah, it's a bullseye in a monoplanar technique.
Monoplanar.
Here you don't have to move the C-arm towards the 30 degrees.
Okay.
Just hold on. Sir. So here we are going inside. I'm targeting the lateralmost calyx of the superior calyx, lateralmost part. Here I go inside. I keep my needle there. Once I see that it's moving with the ureter, with the respiration, see, it's a very medial puncture. You can see the medial, I'm just lateral to the source. You can see how beautifully the water is coming. So with such clear egress of fluid, you are confident that your puncture is in the right position and you are going to enter the system from the posterior most aspect of the calyx, where bleeding complications are very less. See, once I dilated also, there is no hematuria or bloody fluid is there. It's almost a clear fluid. And once we go inside, you can see that I'm walking in the, this is the inferior calyx I walked into from the superior calyx. I come back and then I go towards the upper ureter also. On the medial side, there is ureter. This is the ureter. You can see the ureter also. So once the stone is cleared, this was the done with without any nephrostomy. We did this case. Now again, I want to highlight the inferior calyx puncture once more, because many of us, we try to approach the stones from the inferior calyx because it's the safest zone from which we can enter the kidney. So I'm planning to show one more case here. This case was a 72-year-old gentleman who was having almost a 2.5 centimeter stone. It's a non-dilated system. You can see the cup of the calyx also. The calyces are not dilated as we see routinely in the case of pelvic stone.
Yes.
Now the challenge here was he was on antiplatelet drugs and Ecosprin 75 mg was continuously given. I have not stopped the Ecosprin 75 as it was not advised by his cardiologist. Now you can see the difference in superior calyx. I have not kept any distance between the needle and the calyx. Here I keep almost a 2 to 2.5 centimeter distance. And then I target the cup of the posterior calyx in the 0 degree itself. The CM is fixed. I'm not handling the CM at all. In a single go, see, I'm moving the kidney. The kidney has been moved. With the jerky movements, I enter the kidney from the cup.
Yeah.
And that's it. I will just place it here. And once we remove the stelate, and when we start aspirating, it's a non-edited video. It's a continuous video recording which has been done. You can see clear aspirate of the liquid. So hardly in 10 seconds, I'm inside the kidney. It just takes almost 10 seconds to go inside the kidney. And when the track is, when you come from the posterior most aspect of a calyx, the wire walks into the ureter. And when you are coming from anterior aspect of any calyx, the wire has to negotiate a curve and then go into the ureter. See here, the wire is going directly into the pelvis.
Right.
Still, I will try to manipulate it in the ureter. It has gone into the ureter itself.
Right. This posterior calyx is very important in PCNL.
Yes, sir. You can see the straight path of the wire. There is no kink in the wire itself. That means you are always, in this technique also, you are always coming from the posterior most aspect of the calyx itself. There is no kink in the wire.
Yes.
So after the glide wire maneuvering, the glide wire has walked into the ureter. Now slowly, I will start dilating the track. I want to show the dilatation also because many a times there is a confusion with this technique that the dilatation is not that easy, or there is there are curves and there are angulations in the dilatation. It's not so. You can easily dilate in a straight path towards the desired calyx. So this is the technique what I use. I use a polydrape so that the fluid, all the irrigation fluid, it comes into a bucket. And we have done a single step dilator with the integrated Shah sheath. This is an integrated Shah sheath where the dilator comes with the sheath itself. So directly you dilate. Once you are confident that you have hit the posterior most aspect of the calyx, you directly go inside the calyx with the sheath. Sorry, I've just told.
Yes.
Yes, sir. So we are doing a screwing movements of the integrated shaft sheets with its dilator. So I am coming directly into the system. So once we remove this, I remove the dilator and we keep the sheath in C2. You can see clear egress of the clear liquid. So once we go inside, so this was the system. It was a impacted stone. And once we clear the stone, you can easily walk into the ureter itself. This is the ureter, nicely seen. And with this puncture technique, it's very easy to roam around the kidney. So I come back, I again go into the pelvis, I go into the superior calyx. This is the superior calyx which I'm entering right now. You can see the superior calyx cup. Come back, go into the middle calyx. So this is the middle calyx. Yes, sir.
One question is asked by Rahul Sabu.
Yes, sir. This is the stent.
Are you using single step dilatation routinely or you use sequential dilatation? What is the size of the sheath and what is the scope you use?
Yes, sir. Sir, I routinely do single step only. All my PCNL PCNLs are in single step only. Whether I am using a shaft sheath for mini PCNL or standard PCNL, also I use amplats made by Cook Company. All the PCNLs are done in single step manner only. I don't know where my sequential dilators are kept right now in the OT.
Very good. So what is the nephroscope you use?
So, yes, sir. For mini PCNL, I use Storrs mini PCNL. Yes, sir. And for standard PCNLs, I use Wolf. I have 21 French, Panview Universal, and also for large Stagons, as my the city which I practice, I have a large pattern of Stagon hard stones. I have a 26 French Wolf nephroscope also for me.
Okay. And they have asked the price of the Shashit, even though it is not correct forum, because it is unofficial forum we can share. Average Indian rupees, how much it will cost Shah sheath average?
Yes,
you tell the range because it may not be correct.
Yes, sir.
Any conflicts of interest. It's helped to help the people. Everybody wants to buy one day or another day. You have to buy something or the other. There is no point hiding. Definitely. So you are using so commonly the Shah sheath. We wanted to know what is the average cost of the sheath.
Definitely, sir. Shah sheath, it comes in, they give three sheaths. Ranging from 12 French, 15 French, 18 French, and also 24 French. And with a suction device and a suction machine, it comes around to 60 to 70,000 rupees is the range.
Okay. And one question is asked, every time you do, how do you decide the angle of the entry? Every time you keep 30 degree angle with the skin, or how do you decide the angle by Dr. Siddhalinga Swami?
Yes, sir. Sir, every time I keep almost 30 degree to the surface, skin surface. Okay. And then looking at the calyx, whether at times the system is too much dilated, then we have to come a little bit lateral, make your needle slant a little more. When the system is non-dilated, that means the kidney is not a bulky kidney. Then you have to come more vertical, more medial, so that you have to be close to the calyx.
As you said, it is your first slide, second slide, third slide, now slide is perception.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Some question from Manu Sharma, that is your lead apron sterile. What is the advantage of wearing lead apron over the sterile ground? It is actually criticism. I understand many of the urologists. See, this is a forum, very unofficially we are discussing about the techniques. Most of us, even sometimes, sorry to say, that I also wear lead apron.
Right.
First of all, we have to clean the lead apron and you should not make it. Most of the urology procedures are clean procedures. So lead apron also should be clean. Always better to wear inside. Sometimes what happens, before I ask you, I will support you saying that I puncture and remove the lead apron after dilatation. And do my entire procedure. At the end, I will wear the lead apron. What is your opinion? Sir. Because it is a criticism. I understand you should always be sterile. I use a plastic apron over the lead instead of a gown. What do you say?
Right, sir. Definitely, sir. No, I always wear a lead apron and wear a plastic apron and then wear my sterile gown. But in this case, what happened? I was assisting my wife for a delivery and already everything was kept ready on the table on the other OT. So I have to rush because the anesthetist have already given the anesthesia and there was an emergency labor for this same case. Okay, and I had to assist the labor and come back.
Okay, fine. Now the Ravi Jain, your close friend and my close friend is asking, when do you feel biplanar puncture is necessary in your, you can't say that I never use, but sometimes when you use it, when it was necessary, Arsha?
So biplanar, when I'm more careful, means always every PCNL I do it very carefully, but I'm more cautious when I'm operating in a non-dilated system in a solitary kidney. At that time only, I just do biplanar just to confirm whether I'm exactly inside or not. Okay. Otherwise, even in the ectopic kidneys, which I'm going to share the last video, I do it in monoplanar only. I find it very comfortable doing it in monoplanar technique only.
Again, Dr. Siddhalinga Swami is not leaving you. He's asking,
yes, sir,
mal-rotated kidney, how do you do then? You all do CT. It is the 30 right. degree will not work out for you. So,
again with the same point. Matters? Yes, sir. Again, perception do matters because in mal-rotated kidneys, mostly the pelvis is anteriorly rotated in a mal-rotated kidney, and the calluses, their direction is directed posteriorly. In such cases, monoplanar becomes more easier than doing a bullseye or triangulation technique because the posteriorly, the more posteriorly the calluses are faced,
like superior calluses point.
The posterior calyxer puncture, sir. It becomes more easy to come inside.
Yes. That is a good answer. That is a good answer because most of the kidneys are mal-rotated towards the anterior side. The calyces are faced to the back. Again, you are on the back. Sir. So you will go little medially, little vertical tract and directly end on, you will go.
Yes, directly enter. Yes.
One more question.
And as the CM is more...
more Hello? Vertical.
Sir, one more point here in mal-rotated kidney, as the CM is again vertically placed in 0 degree only, it indirectly becomes a bullseye puncture only.
Okay. Yes.
Yes, sir.
Lot of people are watching, lot of people are asking questions. I have not asked this many questions. Dr. Rahul, is the sheath reusable in terms of its efficacy? How many times you can use it? Give the honest answer.
Yes, sir, definitely. Dr. Rahul, it's a very nice question. It's easy to sterile and I have not changed the sheath. I'm using it since almost 8 months now. And I've done on a single 18 French sheath, I've done almost 200 mini PCNLs till date with that sheath.
Oh my God.
I'm finding it more nice with the when you compare it with the Cook's sheath because the Cook's sheath, it becomes blood. After some time here, the sheath is sharp-edged, but it's very sturdy and you can use it for many cases. Sure, I'm sure about it.
Very good. That is a good feedback. And Vivek Pai has asked, do you have a PCNL program, sir? And if yes, how can we get details for the same? Anyway, you can answer because I still say that this forum is to help the juniors, not to impress the seniors. This forum is to help the juniors, not to impress the seniors. So please answer, do you have any training program?
Yes, sir. I do routinely training. It's not an official program, but soon we are going to make it official. I have almost trained 4 to 5 juniors who were very close to me. They were with me for almost a month and now they are doing it nicely. After the COVID wave is over, I guess I can officially announce the program details.
Yeah, good. And Praveen Ladha has said excellent presentation and video very helpful. So you have one more video, we will go ahead.
Yes, sir. Last video here. I want to show an interesting case which we discussed. This case was discussed on Starbucks group with many seniors, and I found it very useful to be in touch with such great personalities like Dr. Chandramohan sir, Sabnis sir, Pal sir, Kaushik Shah sir, Rajesh Kukreja sir. Those who are always helping in helping mode. This case, it was a case of ectopic kidney.
Yes. Visible.
Yes, sir. Okay, sir, this was a case of 26-year-old gentleman with left cross-fused ectopia, and he had a 2.5 centimeter large stone in the left crossed ectopic kidney. History of degestenting was there 10 days back for the flank pain he was having. Now, in such cases, the treatment options which we could jot down were laparoscopic assisted PCNL, which many of them told me to do, go ahead with laparoscopy assisted PCNL, because it's an almost formulated treatment of choice for such cases. Again, RIRS in expert hands such as Kandar Parikh sir or Chandramohan sir, RIRS is just a few minutes for this case. Total laparoscopic pyelolithotomy was another option. Open pyelolithotomy was the option. Supine PCNL, USG guided, was an option. But the last thing which was the option left with me was prone PCNL fluoro guided, because I am more trained in PCNL fluoroscopy guided. So I tried, why not to go after studying the detail anatomy on the CTs, I plan to go for a prone PCNL fluoro guided, that too in a monoplanar technique puncture.
Okay.
So this was the CT scan images. You can see it's an anteriorly rotated kidney again. In the left pelvic region, it's completely anteriorly rotated. The stone is in the pelvis, and we
have. Sir, I wanted to ask a question. Pause, please.
Right, sir.
Do you see a CT scan very carefully and analyze the colonic relation, anterior, posterior, whether it is ectopic or non-ectopic? Do you think that in any of the present era, plain CT with close cuts is more important?
Definitely, sir, we have to analyze each and every case, because it's a Pandora box inside. When you puncture, you can get a clear fluid, otherwise there will be a bloodshed everywhere. So, and there can be a colonic injury also. Similarly, in this case only, I'm going to talk about the same. You can see that there is an anteriorly rotated kidney with a stone in the pelvis facing towards the abdomen. And I had a very small window through the source which I have to enter. And it was a puncture through the source. So depth of the puncture was so much that almost my IP needle, I had the length of the IP needle was finished while before reaching the kidney itself.
Yes.
And secondly, as I show the video, I had to traverse the source muscle. So I had a torque initially with the first puncture which I made, and which made me to do another puncture also. So we'll go ahead with the video. Here we can see. And there was a little window in the colon also. So we have to be very accurate in such cases. You have to study the CT image itself. So we did a prone PCNL fluoro guided. This case was done in general anesthesia. As we were anticipating laparoscopy also, we kept laparoscopy standby. So anticipated difficulties were major organ injury and colonic injury. So this was the right ureter. Again, I want to make a point here that you can see that this was the region where I have to enter, because the right ureter was sitting just lateral to my puncture and dilatation tract. So I have to be careful to avoid the right ureteric injury also in such cases.
Yes.
Yes, sir. So we did a supine position RGP first was done, just to see the anatomy and everything. So you can see nicely that the left kidney has crossed the midline and come in the pelvic region. This is the prone positioning RGP.
Yes.
Yes, sir. So our first aim was to come from the superior calyx. I've instilled some air. I've done an air pyelogram in this case, because I have to be damn sure that I'm hitting the posterior most aspect of the calyx. If not, then the length of the scope and the length of the amplas would have finished before reaching the stone itself.
Excellent.
So, yes, sir. So we went ahead, and now again here, I'm doing almost a vertical puncture very close to the calyx. I'm keeping the needle. Here I was not afraid of having some radiations to my hand, because this was some crucial case. You can see, almost all the length of the needle was inside as we traversed the source muscle. A clear aspirate was seen, a very clear aspirate was seen, and that gave me a sign of relief, so that I was planning to dilate the tract. So this tract, in a very first go, we could dilate the, we could go inside, hit the posterior calyx and put a wire which walked into the ureter. Again, if you come from the posterior aspect of the calyx, you can see there is no kinking of the wire. the wire is walking into the ureter itself directly. So we place the wire, we confirmed that it has gone into the ureter. Once this was done, we started to dilate the track. We did a single step dilatation with the Shah's 18 French super puck sheath. We dilated the track. This is the Shah's sheath which is kept. It's a Siam image you are seeing. Once this was done, this track dilatation was done, we were able to see a part of the stone. Now, the problem started in this case that only a part was visible as we were traversing from the source muscle and there was a lot of torque which I was having while manipulating my sheath. It was not easy at all. Even though I was perfectly inside the kidney, I was not able to manipulate my sheath as it was going through the source muscle and it was becoming difficult. So only a part of the stone was cleared from this puncture. Then we planned again a second puncture. See, only a part of the stone is cleared. Even I used a flexible to clear the stone, but it was getting difficult. So what we did a inferior calyx puncture again and then went inside, and again you can see that the stone was clearly seen and we could easily clear it. But the thing was that you have to be very confident while doing two punctures in an ectopic kidney. But we were lucky enough to get rid of the stone, clear the stone, place a DJ. And then while coming out, I've shown the track. The track is nicely seen. See, I've come through the source. This is the kidney. I'm coming out. This is the source. These are the transverse abdominis. And I'm coming out. And we have this is the subcutaneous tissue. Yes, sir.
Yeah, yeah.
So these were the two tracks which we made. And this was the stent which we placed. So at last, I want to say that practice and love for PCNL will lead you to a perfect puncture. If Arjuna can practice and hit an eye of a fish while looking into a pond, if he can, we can also. So all the best for all those who are interested in PCNL. Keep on going and keep on puncturing. Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much. One question is asked from the Ravi Jain again. I also have this question repeatedly asked because after doing so many cases also in PCNL, I try to use a pneumatic litho more than a laser. What is your take when you use laser lithotripsy in like few days back, Dr. Kukreja said most of the times you do pieces and they come out with the washing machine effect. But I feel unnecessary uses of laser energy in PCNL. Pneumatic lithotripsy is so good. In fact, whenever I get doubt, I go up to 18-20 French if the good in a medium-sized stone. I want to quickly make bigger pieces and take it out. It is a human tendency. For a long time, SK Pal sir used to say that for a large stone, 30 French is better and you can remove in 4 pieces. Stone-free rate is better. I agree that even today, sometimes I get tempted to go to 30 French in a very good puncture, large infundibulum. What is your opinion? What is your opinion of pneumatic lithotripter versus laser?
Yes, sir. Mostly I used to do laser in some cases, but then
you stop sharing the screen, then so that we can ask.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Definitely, sir. Definitely. Just hold on. Yes, sir.
Yes.
Right. Before introduction of the Shah sheath with the suction device, I used to do a laser for stones around 2 cm to 1.5 cm so that I could do a mini PCNL like 15 French or an 18 French and then clear all the dust from the same whirlpool effect or the vacuum effect which a mini PCNL creates. But yes, after introduction of the Shah sheath, now with the suction, it becomes very easy. Once you do a pneumatic, just fragment the stones and just do in and out 4 to 5 times and all the stones, they come out easily. And it's okay. It gives a complete clearance as well. The same thing which we do routinely, if there is a Stagon stone, we do a 26 French dilatation and then remove all the big particles, the same effect and the same clearance rate is achieved with the Shah sheath also. And the best advantage of doing a Shah sheath is that in inferior pole, all the dust they tend to get migrated in the inferior pole when you are doing a pelvic stone. So just keeping your Shah sheath at the infundibulum of the inferior calyx, all the suction, it causes the dust to come out so that even the small particles, they don't remain inside.
Yeah, yeah. So I will quickly ask 10 questions, quick fire.
Yes, sir.
Ravijayan has asked one more question. In the ectopic case, any concern for fluid extravasation?
I guess no, because the peritoneum was quite anterior to the kidney, and we were eating the quite anterior to the kidney, and we were coming from the source. We were too medial, so there was no risk of any fluid extravasation.
The tract closes immediately the moment you come out.
So we have not kept a PCN also in this case.
Okay. Now I will ask brief questions for the juniors. It may be helpful. Number one, when do you put nephrostomy tube? Quick fire. When do you do nephrostomy? Nephrostomy tube in your cases.
Definitely, sir. So I keep nephrostomy in only two circumstances. If there is a pyonephrosis there, when I'm suspecting an infective pathology there. And secondly, if there is a somewhat reddish, because I am very keen to see a clear egress of fluid while doing a PCNL. If I'm not happy with the color of the retaining fluid, I do tend to keep a PCN tube. But mostly I don't keep, because I routinely do many mini PCNL only. And in case of a stag on, then I try to keep.
I don't understand, Harsha.
Yes.
Everybody answers this. If there is bleeding, how does the nephrostomy help? It's a always repeatedly asked question. Does it close the bleeder? Nephrostomy closes the bleeder?
No, sir.
Then how it helps, sir? But no, it sir, stops, either. Sir. Somehow it stops. Even I keep if the bleeding is there.
Yes, sir.
I feel it may keep little bit of pressure on the vein. I have a little gut feeling.
Right, we don't know.
Chalo, next question is, if a post-operative case, if you are doing post pyelolithotomy or post PCNL, do you feel PCNL is little difficult or it is okay?
So surprisingly, I have a different opinion than others. If a post PCNL case, I'm again doing a PCNL, I find it very easy to do because there is a fibrosis between the skin and the kidney surface area. The kidney is much more towards the posterior side of the abdomen. It is more closer to the skin. And you can go easily inside. The only thing here is that you have to have a very tough tissue dilator, because otherwise, then when you try to do initial tissue dilatation, the wire tries to slip out of the kidney. If the
you have sent me a tough dilator, some blue one.
Yes, sir.
You have sent me, because I am doing supine PCNL, it was slipping out.
Yes,
which company it belongs to? Again, no conflicts of interest. It is very good. Which company it is?
It is a 4A surgical company, sir. It is a Bombay-based company.
It's a Maharashtrian company?
Yes, sir, it's a Maharashtrian company.
Okay, that is very good for any persons who are beginners. 4A surgical company, I have taken it. He has sent to me, Arshavardhan has posted me. It is really helpful. Now, in obese patients, when you are doing PCNL, what is in your mind? You go in the same mind or something, you are afraid, or you inject thick contrast, or what are the extra measures you take in morbidly obese, more than 130, 120 kg?
Right, sir. Yesterday only I did one case of 120 kgs. It was a stag on stone. The only concerns in a morbidly obese patients are the length of the amplatz. You have to be very sure that, okay, you are going to fit in your normal size amplatz to the pelvis, not to the desired calyx. Because once you start operating, you are going to go inside the kidney. So it's not the length of the amplatz that is to be calculated from the calyx to the skin. It has to be calculated from, I should tell, that opposite wall of the pelvis towards the skin. If it's not so, then there are some amplatz which are available in the market, which are extra length. And there are some tips and tricks which we can do. We can suture the amplatz and then let it go inside, or take a deep cut in the subcutaneous tissue so that they can go easily towards the desired calyx.
If you have perforated the medial wall of the pelvis partially, yes, and one stone has gone inside, and do you go in outside the pelvis sometime and take it out, or leave it, or if it is easily seen, quickly take it out, or what do you do?
So if it's easily seen, and if it's a stone which should be removed, if it's a microfibrin, I just leave it there. And if it's easily approachable, in a single go, I remove it.
Okay. Yes, sir. You stent from above or below?
From above, sir. From above.
From above. If you have difficulty in passing the stent from above, what are the tips you tell to the juniors?
Yes, sir. If you have mostly when you pass an anti-grade stent from above, two things are there which can cause trouble. One is a migrated stone which can go in the ureter when you are blasting, when you are doing a lithotripsy, the stone can just go with the flow of the water. So in such cases, first, what you do is you take a Siam image in the ureter also until the VUJ is there. If you see a stone, what you do, you just remove your slowly pull out your ureteric catheter and start flushing with saline. The stone fragments, they do come up at times. Second problem is there is a kink in your catheter, periurethral catheter, which you have kept, and this leads to the full bladder when you are doing a PCNL for a long time. And if the bladder is full, the VUJ tends to get closed. At such time, you have to just see whether your urine bag is having collected urine or not. Once you start draining the urine, the bladder deflates and easily the stent walks inside.
Okay. In supracoastal puncture, do you ask the anesthetist or patient to stop the respiration or no need?
In supracoastal puncture, as I do all the PCNLs in spinal anesthesia only, I'm talking with the patient continuously till the time his desired calyx comes in a range of my initial puncture needle. So I try to ask the patient to inspirate and slowly release the air so that the desired calyx comes very close to my IP needle.
Okay. Do you do postoperative X-ray in all cases of supracoastal or no?
No, sir. No, no.
No. Do you do culture in PCNL or no? Last question.
No, not at all.
No. Okay. Thank you very much. You have been, you have shown excellent command in the answers that shows the amount of the knowledge and dedication and understanding of the three-dimensional anatomy. I really appreciate you. There is a long career for you. I wish you all the best. With this, we will conclude the talk. And tomorrow, for all the viewers, we are coming up with a different topic, 50 watts laser. Can we do enucleation of prostate because it is cost-effective? By Sadashiv Bole from Nagpur. Keep watching. Thank you, Harshavardhan, for sharing your valuable time.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for giving this wonderful opportunity.
A lot of audience still online. A lot of audience are there. More than 240 have seen the program in and out. Thank you very much, Harsha.
Thank you, sir.